Coming up on Hold All Tickets, a massive weekend of racing to preview across, well, the Eastern and Western Seaboard. Lammy, importantly, an unprecedented amount of votes for this season in the trumpets.
Equal highest ever dished out. 8 votes for one trumpeter, some incredible third person work. I also like a $21 chance at Mornington, a local galloper to keep an eye on.
No Liam Clancy from this week as he is on holidays in a shock horror, but we'll be joined by Darren from Betfair. Check it all out. Hold All Tickets starts right now. Hello and welcome to Hold All Tickets. It is the 18th of April as we look ahead to a massive weekend across 3 states. We've got the final Group 1 day in Sydney with the all-age stakes and the champagne. We've got Mornington Cup day as well as the Hariba there. And of course, the final day of the Western Trilogy. It is the Quokka over West. I'm your host, Alex Donnelly, as always joined by James Lamb. Lammy, how are we?
Very well. Looking forward to the Quokka at the end of the Mornington card. It's, as you mentioned, going to be a very big day of Saturday racing.
Absolutely love it. And of course, we are brought to you by our friends at Betfair. They're on your side this autumn racing season. Check out Betfair today. Now, no Liam Clancy because, well, he worked for 6 weeks and he needed a holiday.
He's due for a spell.
Yeah, we'll be joined by Darren Parkin from Betfair. But before we get to that, as always on today's show, we've got the yays or nays, the self-trumpeter of the week. But before we get started, please make sure you subscribe and follow us on Spotify and Apple Podcasts. Also subscribe on YouTube and give this video a thumbs up. And of course, across the social medias, X, Facebook, Instagram, at Punters. Lammy, let's start off with the yays or nays.
Yes, one for you. After another poor showing at Canterbury on Wednesday, Shelby 66 should be retired from racing. Yay or nay?
Nice little half volley to start the day. Absolutely yay. I think we said this in the spring when he was getting beaten 100 yards in group races. He was running in just a lowly benchmark race at Canterbury yesterday. He started 70-1 and he finished last, near enough to last. It's almost sad to see. Like, it's uncompetitive. Like, he had that great spring, or autumn, sorry, 2 years ago now, and he hasn't looked like getting near him since. Just, they need to step in and retire the horse for the sake of it.
I was originally a hard yay on this.
Yeah.
But when you go through his form, he's not getting smashed. He was beaten under 5 lengths at his last couple. Only because he has a Group 1 to his name that we're having this discussion, I think. If he's getting belted by over 10 lengths every start, then, yeah, I think it's time. But I don't know, 5 lengths, it's kind of on the edge, the cusp. I can see both sides of the argument.
Yeah, well, it's his SPs, you look at it, and he hasn't sort of got within 4 or 5 lengths of the winner in, what, his last 10 to 15 starts. Mm. So, anyway.
Yep.
All right, here we go. This will get some people talking. Lammy, trainers talking about actively avoiding Pride of Jenni in the future is a touch over the top.
Absolutely, it is. Yay, it is over the top. As are the comparisons to Winx and Black Caviar. Obviously, Jenni is an unbelievable horse, but she's not unbeatable. She was rolled by Cascadian in the Oz Cup 2 starts ago.
Yeah.
Amelia's Jewel beat her twice last spring. Admittedly, Pride of Jenni was still building at the time, but she can be run down. We've seen it many times.
It's not like she's running 159 for the 2,000 metres.
No. And look, enough has been said about the QE. It's been dissected to death. But, I mean, the other jockeys weren't trying to beat Pride of Jenni there. Willow wanted to run 2nd or 3rd.
Yep.
He stacked him up. Nothing. Everyone was too scared to make a move. The race was served up to her on a plate. It was an unbelievable performance. But, I mean, horses were breaking 11 seconds on the way home across the last 600 metres. Like, they were smashing the clock because they just jogged.
How's your all-important cover now, you cowards?
Yes. Well, look, I think take her on again. Absolutely take her on again, but have an actual plan.
Have a crack.
Don't just go out there and wait for something else.
How did Damien Lane beat her?
Yeah, he went forward and applied a bit of pressure early and eventually wore it down. So, yeah, I think the talk of avoiding her going forward is quite ridiculous.
If you're a good horse and you're avoiding Pride of Jenni, you are costing yourself a lot of money.
Well, the best races growing up were always when, you know, Northerly was taking on Sunline and those stouches, those one-on-one battles.
What about when Haylish was like, you know, we're going to have a crack?
Never shied away from Black Caviar. Absolutely take it on. It's ridiculous. Private Eye needs to win the all-age on Saturday or it's been a wasted autumn for Joe Pride and his stable stars. Yay or nay?
Yay, because I think he zigged when he should have zagged a few times. Private Eye should have, similar to an Espiona who we'll talk about later, probably should have run and won the Newmarket, but he stayed at 1,000 metres and got a horrendous ride. Then he copped a horrendous ride in the Galaxy, which again, probably wasn't the right race for him. You look at think about it. Hasn't had the best of times this autumn. He didn't cop the best of riding the Canterbury Stakes, then had to do a lot of work from a wide gate into George Ryder and the Donny. I can't even remember how he ran.
So a few things have conspired against Joe Pryor.
Yeah, and then Sia Wolf, you know, probably should have won at the Derby, but copped a freak ride by J-Mac to beat him. And you look at that and you go, I've won a Derby. It's been a great, you know, autumn for him. And just a few of the other ones we thought would step up didn't really come up.
Yep.
So, yeah.
It's a yay.
Yeah, it's a yay. Finally, the recently retired Imperatriz should win Horse of the Year after five Group 1s this season.
Nay, five Group 1s is an incredible effort and her wins at the Valley were sensational. But I think the Cup's double is a bigger achievement.
Oh, so you're going without a fight?
Yes.
Okay.
I am.
I'm different to you.
Yeah. I think without a fight took on the best stayers here, which admittedly they're not great, but a few high quality internationals as well, beat them in the Caulfield Cup and the Melbourne Cup. Yeah. That Melbourne Cup win, he had 56 and a half with the 1 kilo penalty from the Caulfield Cup and won by nearly 2.5 lengths. Sulcombe was unlucky.
Mark Zara did sit up at the 50 to celebrate.
Yeah, it was a huge performance. And look, Pride of Jenni, obviously also in the conversation
I'm in that camp.
Without a fight for me, the Cup's double. They don't grow on trees.
So I'm with Pride of Jenni because without a fight, yes, Cup's double. But if Pride of Jenni hadn't have won the Queen Elizabeth, I'd be with you. She won the two Group 1s in the week over Flemington. She won the All-Star Mile, just got run down in Australian Cup, and then she won the Queen Elizabeth, which is supposedly the jewel of the autumn, by 6.5. So I think given she did it in both seasons, two Group 1s, or the All-Star Mile is technically a Group 1 without the name, I think with those four wins, she deserves it.
It's a pretty competitive field this year, given there's been years where we've had, you know, Nature Strips clearly Winks. Been, or Animo clearly, and before that Winks, but caviar. So it's a good debate.
I like it. All right, let's get to the self-trumpeters of the week. Lammy, now as we remind everyone, no shock, Andrew Hawkins is leading. He's on 10 votes. Then with a bunch of chases on 6, 5, and 4.
Yeah, big week. And I'll just jump straight into it because there's plenty to get through. One vote, Ben Dorries. Basically 12 months to the day, Dorries boasted about being invited into the private dining room at Ascot with Bjorn Baker. Well, he's in Perth again for the Quokka. And
hashtag junket.
He's once again brought his trumpet. Ben wrote this in today's RaceNet column.
Yeah.
Leave me out of bleak Melbourne and hectic Sydney. I have more invites to long lunches this week than you'd believe. So countless long lunch invites for the big show rolling into town. That's a vote.
I thought he was there for work.
He's there for work. but yeah, I have more invites to long lunches this week than you would believe. One vote, it probably should have been more, but because his vote last year was new part season. Of last year's, it's a new season. He hasn't polled yet this year.
That's disappointing.
To my knowledge. So one vote Dorries. One vote, a man who has polled many times, Andrew Hawkins. Hawk has another gig. He's had more jobs than hot dinners, but this sounds like a ripper, this job. He tweeted during the week, excited to get my first chance to work on an Olympics come July with Channel 9. Working behind the scenes as a researcher, dream job for the 5-year-old me who could name every host city. So the trumpet there, little hidden one, 5-year-old me who could name every host city. It's an uncommon trumpet, the child reflection back to that time, but it's a trumpet all the same.
Yeah.
I can just see a little 5-year-old hawk rattling off all the host cities. And
can confirm this is it. Like ever since I've known him, I think I've known him for about 15 years now, he has always talked about working or covering the Olympics in some aspect. So this is a big bucket list thing for him as
well. He'll be in an absolute muck lather.
So if just as a warning for everyone on Twitter, the month of the 2 weeks leading up to the Olympics and the 2 weeks
if
of it.
Don't like the Olympics.
Just mute him. I muted him before whatever the last Olympics was. Yeah, 4 years ago. Or 3 years ago for Tokyo. So there's your warning, punters.
Very good. One vote also, Josh Shields. He posted a screenshot of a lazy 28K run he had on Saturday morning with the caption, PB, personal best Saturdays ain't bad. Now it's time for a fill up. Let's go. So apparently the time of 2 hours and 20 minutes is red hot.
Great clip.
I wouldn't know as I can't run for the train without doing a hammy. But yeah, I do know a trumpet when I see it, and it is a trumpet. I don't know about the time, but it is a trumpet. One vote.
He's lucky he missed a few weeks ago for posting the selfie at Crown or wherever he was too. Yeah. We had too many votes that week.
Two votes, get into the multiple ones now. Paul Moroney, a one voter upgraded to two for repeat offending in this space. New Zealand Bloodstock tweeted, the number of stakes-winning graduates to come out of Karaka 2022 went up to 40 on Saturday with three additions, et cetera, et cetera.
Yep.
Paul replied, that's impressive. 10% belong to our selections. And I think we can safely assume that by ours, he means his, my selection.
Yeah, it's himself and Catherine, his partner.
Okay, well, Catherine.
But no mention of Catherine.
No mention
there,
of Catherine.
Yeah.
Yep.
Well done, Catherine.
Two votes for Paul, no votes for Catherine. Eight votes. Eight. Should have built it up a bit more. I don't know if it's unprecedented because I think Miles might have polled at eight
he
last
did eight.
Season.
Yeah.
So eight votes for Dave Portnoy.
Oh, yes, yep.
He's an American businessman and founder of Barstool Sports. Not short of a buck and evidently loves a punt.
He's a genius, that bloke. He sold his business twice for about $1 billion and now he owns it for nothing.
Yep. Well, just hold off on your praise. There's enough that he's given to himself. He calls himself El Presidente or El Prez, just FYI. So Dave tweeted this during the Masters golf tournament during the week. Guys, I don't think people realise what we are witnessing. To come into the Masters as the world's number one and the hottest gambler on the planet. To have a bullseye on your forehead and still win with ease. We may never see a four-month stretch like this again. Hashtag El Prez the All-Knowing. And when I first read this, I thought, this is a fair old pump-up. Who is he? Who is he talking about here? Who is the hottest gambler on the planet? He's talking about himself. His tweet is accompanied by an image of himself looking very stern with a series of dollar amounts on the image. But the bottom line is $5.4 million with the text, combined winnings, Dave Portnoy. So as you can imagine, there's been some very good replies to this extraordinary piece of trumpeting. I think the best one, though, was a photoshopped image of Dave Portnoy putting a gold medal around the neck of Dave Portnoy. So 8 votes for Dave. Are you happy with 8? Do you think it's too much, not enough, or fair?
I think 6 is right because it's no Fitz magic level because that was a continual rampage. His was, 3 tweets? And all weekend he was riding the roller coaster of Scottie Scheffler winning this Masters for this bet as well. So it was... I can see 8, but I also don't want him to finish on the podium this year.
Well, I didn't want to give him too many that he overtook the Hawk, who's put in a power of work to get where he is on the leaderboard. So he probably jumps onto the podium now.
He's second.
Second, yeah. But what's the Hawk on?
11.
11, okay.
Yeah, so I thought John Stewart was copping the 8 when you said 8 votes.
No, I got sick of John Stewart during the week, so I didn't give him any votes.
Yeah. He's lucky.
He probably should have featured.
There would have been 4 or 5 there for him. But geez, that is a big week, Lammy.
Big week for the trumpeters.
Yep. Yep. All right. With that being done and dusted, let's bring in Daz from Betfair. We can have a chat to him and have a look ahead to the awesome weekend of racing we have coming up. All right. Welcome back to Hold All Tickets. And in a shock, you know, Liam Clancy, he did 6 weeks of work. So he's like, you know what, boys? I'm due for a holiday. So we bring in Darren Parkin from Betfair. Is he off junketing or is he actually doing some work this time?
Well, he's in Adelaide, so he might frame it around the start of their carnival. But yeah, it's probably a junket, I would suggest.
Lives a good life out, Liam, doesn't he?
He does. He's got a good gig.
Yeah. All right, let's get into last weekend with the longest price winner on Betfair across the Metro meetings last Saturday.
So we had Bendigo in Victoria with Atlantic Spirit. Of course, it was a significant day there, but Atlantic Spirit, 87.70 BSP, which was also the best price advantage of the day, the best corporate 60s, best totes 60s as well. So that's 44% value. So if you look at the $10 outlay, it's about $280 in the pop there. Ooh. And we had it was a day of, you know, a lot of 20s and 30s, but Morfordville did have Sir Sway get up at $52.62 in race 4. And that was a 52% advantage on best tote at $34.90.
It is just starting to slowly heat up over in Adelaide. I noticed last week that the good little sprint race. So J-Mac now going over there.
First time ever.
Yeah. Mm. I mean, not much to do in Adelaide having been there recently. And the shortest in-play loser, we had a bit of a max out across West.
We did. At Ascot Race 9, you had Becca Lottie hit $1.01, having opened at $8.23 and got rolled by Son of the Boss, who was $1,000 in play. So maxed out $7.75 BSP. So they jumped at about the same price and Becca Lottie got into $1.01 and Son of the Boss at $1,000 and got up.
This race up.
Yeah.
And we also had, so Morfettville, the opening race had a bit of a turnout. Garachico jumped at $2.58, got into $1.13, and then got rolled in that race, ended up finishing second. So the favourite looked the winner for a fair way, but wasn't to be.
Not ideal. I'll skip over the any points of interest from last week, because the one we had was going to be, let's get the pride of Jenni in play things, and you've put out that fantastic video. Well, Betfair has, go check out their socials, of her prices in play. The price you could have got at the 600, where if you were paying attention, she was home.
It has to be bot slaying at that price, doesn't it?
Yeah. Surely. It's like, how, like, at the 600, I was like, she's going to have to fall over here.
Also,
like,
what price for those listening was she at the 600?
She was still above $2.
$2.50 and was 30 lengths in front of Via Sestina, who was the favourite in the race. And it's not like a, you know, you get 100-to-1 pop in a race sometimes that will just take off. And you're like, well, I'll reel it in eventually. But this is Pride of Jenni, who's led all the way and beaten Brightside and Alligator Blood and all of these stars in the past. And she was just running so well that you're like, this isn't a horse that's just going to drop dead and get run down. So,
as talked about in the yays or nays, Lammy, just cowardice by the lot of them.
Yes, bring that up again.
All right, let's get into the recap, though, with the bets from last weekend. We'll start off with Lammy, who went provincial for his first day back from holidays. Finished on a high.
Yes. Best bet was race 2, number 10 at Chalton Lane, which was a very nice win indeed. Storming down the outside at close to $4. Next best, not so good. That was race 8, number 8, Roll on High. Didn't enjoy the best run in transit, but still wasn't flash. Seemingly not the same horse this prep, I don't think. I'm not sure.
How good that form looks around her, though.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, something's gone awry. Yeah. Whether they press on or send her to the paddock, I'm not sure. Best value, race 3, number 1, Rocket Tiger, $18. Went hard, 1/3. Where do you think the Tiger finished?
Four.
As always, four.
And it didn't happen to the last 20 strides, as usual.
It was kicking on quite bravely. Yeah. And then the last 50 metres, it just got the staggers a little bit. The lay was End Assembly, the place, which was scratched. Yep. And it's set to go around at Mornington this Saturday, actually.
Okay. Mm. All right. We'll pay attention to how it goes this weekend. For me, at Randwick, broadsiding was...
A bit of head wobble here, I think.
No. Best bet was... Well. Yeah, well, the best was broadsiding. Job done in the first. That was a beautiful... Right from J-Mac, hit the line well. Interesting to see how he goes on the backup this weekend. The next best was Territory Express in the Midway Championships. Really good ride from Zach Lloyd, and the great story of Paul Nicoforo getting the job done. Him coming out saying Cox Plate after the race. Love it.
Ambitious.
Maybe aim for the Epsom, Paul. Let's tone it down a little bit. The best value was Maharajan in the Sydney Cup. Needed a couple of hurdles. That wasn't great. And they scratched Learning to Fly, because they got scared, and yet they're going to the Sangster.
Yep. Well, your tip on broadsiding must have influenced, because it was the biggest firmer of the day before winning that race. So it certainly had an impact.
I was going the cheap shots recently. Just race 1, the favourite. Let's get off to a good start. It's worked in the carnival for
Backfired
me.
Backfired for me for a while there.
Yeah, it did.
With the lays in the first race.
Flemington wasn't great. And Liam, his best bet was Learning to Fly. It didn't run. So, you know, get a pass mark there. The next best was Tashi, who was no good. His value was Lindemann, who was scratched. And then he laid Schwartz the place, got the job done there. He was very plain second up. So he's getting the lays right, at least. He's been fairly aggressive with them as of late. Yep. All right, let's get to some of the major tips for the weekend before we get into our best bets. The Mornington Cup's where we'll go to first. The win, and you're into the Caulfield Cup, but you probably won't win the Caulfield Cup, as history will tell you.
Probably not. I'm going with First Immortal, who would be some sort of chance in
he
a Caulfield
could
Cup.
Could be the difference.
Probably the exception.
Yeah.
Excellent first up. Poor last time, but I'm willing to forgive one average run because there haven't been too many across his 17 start career. So putting a pen through that one, I think he's the best horse in the race with the best future. So going with First Immortal, probably goes forward from the wide gate.
You think he would.
You think that would be his best chance around a course like Mornington. Got future history in for second, beat First Immortal over 2,500 last prep, so has to be a chance in this third up. Strawberry Rock for third. Racing really well this campaign. And I've got Deny Knowledge in for fourth. Hard to run down if left alone in front. No Pride of Jenni, but is a pretty handy on pacer when left alone. So that's the top four for the Mornington Cup.
Too easy. All right. The last two group ones in Sydney for this season are the Champagne and the All Age Stakes. Of course, at Randwick, the Champagne comes up first. It's race number 7. With number 2, Linebacker, 2 from 2, this colt by Super Seth. Really like the way he's gone about his business in his first two runs. Killed them on debut and then sat on speed. and wore down a node on a day that proved to be you needed to be closer to the fence. Did a good job there, and broadsiding was third there, hitting the line well. So the form out of it stacked up with broadsiding run well. I've got him in for second broadsiding on the quick backup. Horses on the quick backup do have a decent record without winning this race, and he looks to be a nice colt. Got Manal in for third there. Look, she is the favorite here. She's the winner of the size produce. I'm looking for different form outside of the slipper and the size produce form. They did cross the line in a bunch once again. So just at the odds, I want to take her on a little bit. And I've got El Castello in for fourth. He hit the line well in the Fernhill last week behind broadsiding. So I'm going completely DF in this race. Who do you like, Lammy?
For me, it's Manal. Obviously won the size and pretty stiff in the slip. I drew 16 and was basically last at the 400 before finishing just out of the placing. So like her last two runs, but agree with you. You could make a case for any of the top three in the market there. Manal for me to beat the boys that you mentioned.
Any thoughts, Daz?
Yeah, I'm certainly with Manal. I agree on that. I think stepping up to the mile will relish that, and the slipper run more than handy. So, I'm very much in that camp.
Drawn nicely too, barrier four, I think.
Yeah, drawn softly, so shouldn't have to do too much work anyway. But Jay Carr on board, replacing Collard, who broke six ribs last week.
Yes, not ideal.
No, as we know. All age stakes, final group one, 1400 metre weight for age race. This is a pretty damn good field that, you know, for the end of the carnival, and I'm glad they've pumped this up to 1.5 million because for years it was worth about half a million and always forgotten. I'm going with number 9, Espiona, on top. Look, she's done everything but win this preparation. Third in the Lightning, fantastic. Third in the Canterbury Stakes, where they should have gone to the Newmarket. And then great in the TJ, probably should have won with a bit of luck. So hopefully the brakes go her way. She's 5-for-8 over the 1400 metres. Got a great record, handles all conditions, just needs a bit of luck for Nash for once. Sunshine in Paris in for second. She's been running fantastic both runs this time in and not winning. She'll knock me off this time as I haven't tipped her on top. But draw softly in barrier two. Her group one win was over 1400 metres at Randwick. In for third, Southport Tycoon. Do you reckon they're regretting scratching the way that Doncaster played?
Depends how he goes this week.
Yeah, we'll see. If he comes out and wins, they're absolute geniuses getting the weight for age group one. But Jay Carr aboard again. He was a bit poor second up, I thought, over the 1400 metres, but maybe he was a bit flat after a good first up run, but very nice colt. And I got Golden Mile in for fourth. Look, I thought he was fantastic last start in the George Rider. He loomed up and sort of knocked up late, back to the 1400 suitable, and he's massive odds, and he gets the visors on, so he'll be sort of rolling along behind Buffalo River in the run, you would think. He looks to be gone this prep Buffalo River after his run the other day, so it's just
been a long prep.
Yeah, so he could just fade off the turn, and Golden Mile could be the one that kicks off.
Maybe. It could be my Victorian bias coming out here, but I'm going with Southport Tycoon. I just think the Oz Guineas form is rock solid. Back to 1400 is no issue given the gap between runs. And Caron from barrier five, he's a horse who can put himself into the race early. So, yeah, they would have liked the Doncaster, and they probably would have liked to have run in there given the track upgrades, but I think they might be able to pinch this one.
Wait for age later. Group one looks much better
on the CV.
Yeah, it looks better on the CV than a handicap.
Yep.
Yeah, it took the words out of my mouth. I think the freshen up over the, I think it's about 49, nearly 2 months between runs by the time they get there. And I just think shapes really well out of that. Jamie Carr sticking with the ride. I think it had four different jockeys in its previous four starts prior to that. So I think that consistency as well with the form that she's in will help.
Yep. All right. Let's get to the tips. Lammy, you're going provincial once again at Mornington, as said. The big day there.
Yes.
Big fields.
Big fields.
Tricky day.
Yep. Bit of a battle yesterday, but hopefully a few winners. Race six, number five, Rip Roar for my best. Was given a decent break after the spring and bolted in first up over 1340 at Geelong. That was a heavy eight, but he won well on a good four at Bendigo four back, so I'm not concerned about going from a wet track to dry. Actually started $6.50 against Riff Rocket at Flemington last prep, so one for the SP profilers there. Clearly plenty of punters rate his ability. Hopefully Harry Coffey gives him a peach from barrier five. Similar to First Immortal, I think he's the best horse in the race, and I'm just trusting that he's ready to go here.
Front page for mine at Randwick, race five, number seven. The Galaxy Run was full of merit. Loves the distance, loves Randwick. Weighted pretty well, and clearly on top for mine in that race.
All right. We'll go with my best bet then if we're running through it this week. Mine's also front page. Really took the words out of my mouth there. Fantastic first up in the Galaxy Rundown just late there. Go back and look at his form over 1,200 metres at Randwick. If he gets his own time in front, he will absolutely kick this lot's heads in and win really well. I think he's a $1.50 chance. Oh, if he runs up to his Kosciuszko win, he will smash them. Simple as that. Lammy, your next best.
Next best. Race 10 at Mornington, number 4, Dashing. Big fan of this horse. He just drives his guts out every start. I reckon I've probably tipped him on this show 2 or 3 times, maybe more than that. Both runs
Liam
back.
Had him last start too, and yeah, it just hurt him.
Yep. Both runs back have been really good, and form out of his fresh run is red hot. He finished behind Johnny Rocker and Midtown Boss, and of course, Johnny Rocker gave Imperatrix a bit of a scare. So that's pretty good form. Should roll forward from his middle gate, 3 kilo claim, and races in the first 4 or 5 generally. One third up last prep and placed in his only other run at this track. So it ticks a lot of boxes.
Might have to have something on after that, Lammy.
Mm.
Sticking with your mantra from earlier about the first race of the day, going with Perspiration at Mornington.
Like
unlucky at Caulfield last start. Looked like I had a stack more to give that day. Nice track. I think that the draw as well gives a very, very good chance to start the day well.
Mine comes up in race 6, the JRA Plate at Randwick, and with Faulkner Park. Smashed them in the Aubrey Cup last start. It was basically a track gallop. He didn't beat much, but really well placed here, 53.5 kilos, barrier 3. I thought going to Flemington 2 starts ago was a mistake. You saw the way that he hung about in the straight, didn't want to go the right way. His form in Sydney when he wins is quite good. 6 wins from 14 starts. Look, he looks like a horse who could be like maybe a Q22 Doomben Cup type of horse if he wins this. Gets a great run on the map and he handles all going. So I'm pretty happy to be with him.
That was a ridiculously easy win last start.
Please win so you don't go to the Wagga Cup. All I'm asking.
My best value, one at odds at Mornington, race 5, number 11, Impressive Enough, $21. Local gallopers, always very hard to beat at Mornington.
There's always a local that bobs up at big odds.
It's a tricky track, and I'm hoping Impressive Enough is that local. Barrier 3 should settle a lot closer than it did. Was 16th down the straight last start at Flemington and flashed home to finish 2nd behind the smart Midtown Boss. So if it could repeat something close to that, he'd take a power of beating in this. Had one go over this route for a nice 2nd at last prep where he put a real space on the rest. So $21, I think, is definitely overs for the local.
Yep.
Heading to the Cup, I actually think Captain Envious represents a bit of value in that. Can keep the momentum rolling from the Easter Cup. Distance to suit, plenty of room as well. So just backing the form rolling on from that to go close.
Mine comes up in, was it race number 4, the Frank Packer Plate. Going with one of the fillies down at the bottom here, and Our Gold Hope for Robert and Luke Price. Dylan Gibbons takes the ride. Look, only beaten 3.5 lengths by Orchestral, Tutor LaVita and Zardozzi last start in the Vinery, and drops to the minimum here in what is not the best looking race. And she draws gate 2. You go back the form before Queen of Dragons, 2nd in the Kembla Grange Classic. And then before that was behind Mare of Mount Buller, who's a filly I've got plenty of time for. So form looks really good, bringing a different sort of form line to this race than some of these horses who've just been beating up on each other the last few months. And she's big odds currently. And I think from barrier 2, she can give some cheek.
Very good.
Mm. All right, let's get across to the lays of the day this weekend. Of course, they are brought to you by Betfair. They're on your side this autumn racing season. Check out Betfair today. Lammy.
Yes. Going with Mornington Race 8, number 8, Little Mix the Place at 280 last time I looked. Sydney visitor, who they probably had this race penciled as a chance to get into the Caulfield Cup, maybe a weaker chance to get in, but then they've come up with barrier 14, which for a horse who generally gets back, she's probably going to settle in the last few and have to loop them, which can be very tough at Mornington if you don't get a nice cart into the race. So I think she'll just be way too far back and might run a nice 5th or 6th, but won't be placing, hopefully.
Bang.
Take risk based on the value that I put in the Cup. It was a difficult one to find a lay, I thought, this weekend, but First Immortal, obviously off the poor run last time, just some slight queries, certainly capable of bouncing back, and the best form lines obviously rate pretty well, but just coming off that and then you throw in barrier 13, which tactically forces your hand a little bit in a few things. There might be some vulnerability around the fave.
Yeah. The worry is that there was nothing in the stewards report for last start, which I was a little concerned about, but we'll see how we go.
My lay of the day might be Lammy's favourite horse, so I'm a bit of strife here. Yeah, going to Randwick, race 9, number 12, Jimmy Starr. Draws barrier 14 and gets J-Mac on board and comes up favourite. And look, didn't cop the best of rides last start at Newcastle, but really didn't hit the line too strongly. Went stuck on the fence there, of course. We all know what happened with Craig Williams in the ride the week before at Flemington, but I just don't think the form around him's that great, to be honest. There's some nice horses coming in on this. There's good horses who are big odds in this. Like, there's a horse like Brigantine who, if he brings his best, can win this. Same with a horse like Waterford. Even the couple down the bottom, I know, a star in Winchat. Currently about 6-4. I really want to take on Jimmy Starr. He could get stuck on a limb again, and they'll be finding excuses once again.
He features in the back all lays, doesn't he? So I won't say anything.
Yeah, we'll bring it up then. And Lammy with the great segue across to the back all lay. So I've got two horses at Mornington and three at Randwick. We'll start off at Mornington. Well, the first one is race 6, number 5. It is Lammy's best bet. It is Rip Roar. We know what he's doing. He's backing.
Yes, my best on the card. So obvious back for me.
Yep. Back as well. Yep. Not a stack of depth. One in all conditions. Looks sharp. Too good.
Yeah, really well placed. Think he'll get the job done. The next one comes up, race 7, number 3. See What I See. I think we're going to be seeing a pretty good horse.
Yeah, I didn't make her my best because I thought she'd be shorter than $1.70.
Yeah, we thought she'd be $1.30.
Yeah, well, she's $1.90 at the moment, which seems a ridiculously good price. Just doing it easily and just has to get around Mornington. But yeah, I think she'll continue on her winning way.
Well, she's done it at what? Caulfield, the inside Caulfield track and the valley, overcoming a bit of trickiness both times.
Yeah.
Like Mornington shouldn't pose a problem.
Yeah, it was a tough watch at the valley, but got the job done in the end for her backers.
Yeah, this looks like a stepping stone to bigger things. I think we'll be talking about See What I See for a while, and this will be another box ticked in that journey.
I like how they're just going, let's get the prize money, let's just bank it on the way through.
I mean, this is a benchmark. I don't have it in front of me, but I'm pretty sure it's a 78.
Yeah. Well done. Randwick to the Champagne Stakes, race 7, number 7, Manal. I've got a third, so I'm just going to lay her just at the price I want to take her on. I think broadsiding and linebacker represent some good value.
Back for me, I think she just needs to hold her level from the last two starts we've seen from her.
Agree entirely.
Yep. Race 9, number 12, Jimmy Star, lay of the day.
Pains me to say it. I've got him as a lay this week.
Oh, wow.
I still think he'll be a very good horse, but it feels like a bit of an afterthought after the All-Star.
Apparently
they're
Stradbroke chasing now.
Yeah, it just seems like those plans went by the wayside, and this feels like a bit of a funny race for him. Gets J-Mac, but the draw is grim. I don't know where he's going to end up in the run. So, lay.
Yeah, I'm a lay as well. There are some pros, there are some cons, but putting all of that together, the price ends up a bit too short for mine.
Yeah. And finally, a race 10 at number 12, Kazoo for Waller and McDonald, a horse with a big boom on her, and she really hasn't done a lot to date.
She has at times.
Yeah.
But what are you doing? Back or low?
I'm laying her. I just think her SP profile is just, it is very strong, but she just doesn't, like, she got beaten at Cranbourne at $1.60 last start. I know it's by Revolutionary Miss and Spanish Tides, but she's always got an excuse, and I'm sick of finding excuses for her, but her best form is fresh, but I'll take her on.
Yep. I don't think I've been burnt yet, so I'll make her a back. A bit of emotion coming into it over there. Back at, I think, what is she now? $3?
Yeah.
I wouldn't want to be taking less than three, but I think $3 plus. You mentioned the first up record, drawn perfectly, and that helps given a couple of her main dangers have drawn right off the track.
Yeah.
So she will get every chance, but if she can't get the job done here, sack bin.
Yeah,
the excellent fresh record and I think well placed here. Agree with some of the queries on it, but has come up reasonably well priced. So a back, so 4 out of 5 backs for me.
Ooh, I like it. There could be a fat weekend across in Daztown. All right. The biggest race of the weekend, I believe, is across in the West. It is the Quokka. It is a part of the Western Trilogy. Massive day. What's this goes off? It goes off 5:45 on a Saturday afternoon. I hope that's Ascot time. No, it's 5:45 our time. So that's
really
a quick run-in. I suppose they want to, it might be on Channel 7, so they're trying to capitalize on the free-to-air coverage as well.
Quite early.
Yeah, I don't mind it. It means I don't have to pay attention later on in the night. Currently, your favorite is Amelia's Jewel on the exchange. She's $3.50. You got Overpass, $4.70. Bella Nipotina's there, God bless her, $7.20. You're also $7.20 Oscar's Fortune. King of Sparta, the only one under double figures at $8.60. Good race, Lammy.
It is. And it looks a fairly straightforward speed map on paper with obviously Malkovich.
Yep.
He only really knows one way. He'll lead from barrier 2. But Oscar's Fortune, probably room to slide in behind and then Overpass. Shouldn't have any issues lobbing in the first 3 or 4 from barrier 6. And Amelia's Jewel, you would imagine, drifts back from the wide gate. Is that how you see it?
I had the exact same map as you, but I was like, maybe Lane chances his arm to get the 3 wide with cover in the running instead of going back to last like they did last year. What do you think, Daz?
Yeah, I think if you look at Amelia's Jewel and Overpass, who went head-to-head last year, and Jewel almost got it very late, that it all sort of maps similarly. Obviously, you get a much better price on Amelia's Jewel this time around to what you did 12 months ago. You know, Overpass will give themselves every chance, doesn't need a stack of luck, obviously creates those opportunities itself.
Yeah.
King of Sparta, if it can tow with Amelia's Jewel and be hitting the line hard late as well, is some sort of a chance. But I do like Amelia's Jewel. I would hazard a guess probably double what she was last year in the market.
I think she was about evens last year, wasn't she?
Yeah, so we're about 350 now, so let's say around twos last time. So she was a stride away from nutting that one last year, and I think she looks in reasonable shape now.
Yeah. What's your top four, Lammy?
I'm going with last year's winner, Overpass. I think he's the horse to beat again. If you look at his last four first up runs, he won a Group 2, second to Nature Strip, won the Quokka, and was second to Private Eye, beating a lip. So keeping him fresh is evidently the key to him. Got Oscar's Fortune for second, appears to get the dream run for Pikey, who's on the comeback trail from injury. Amelia's dual class mare, can't leave her out, just wish she had have drawn a bit better. Yep. Might be spotting them too much of a start. And got one at 80 to 1 to throw in Exotics.
I wanted to question this and be like, why?
Triple Missile, well travelled. It's been around, been with a few different trainers, seen a campaign in Victoria for a while there. On its day, it has a killer finale. Just when it's cuddled up and safe for one dash at them, I could see it poking into fourth at a monster price.
Okay, yeah. Mm. I was going to question this. I was just like...
Certainly not declaring it, but for those that like to play first fours, chuck it in for fourth.
Yep. I've got the same top three as you, just in a different order. I've got Oscar's Fortune on top. I thought he was fantastic first up when winning the Roma Cup. Everyone will be like, oh, did you see how Amelia's jewel closed? It's like, well, yes, she was just doing it easy out the back while Oscar's Fortune was bang on speed, kicked away, and the race was over at the 300-meter mark. Pike once again gets the dream run here. I think he and Overpass will fight this one out. I think Malkovich sort of whips them into the turn, drops off, and one of them looks the winner at the 300. Just depends on, who's the better horse on the day. I've obviously got Amelia's jewel in for third. Look, you can't not have her in there. That turn of foot she has is wicked. She'll be finishing really well. I'm throwing in King of Sparta for fourth. Bishin from Barrier 4 will just sit off one off the fence, and he will duck and weave and look to produce the D. Oliver Munamek ride. That's what I'm producing here for Shinny. And throw in Ripcord in for your Exotics as well. He's about 20s or 30s at the moment. He'll hit the line well. It's a really good race this year.
It is.
Really like it.
Looking forward to it.
Yep. Make sure you also check out all the social media content going up across Punters, across the Western Trilogy. There is an abundance of stuff going up there, as well as the written preview that should be up right now. I think Jet has also done a runner by runner.
Hardworking man, Jet.
He is, and a great mustache. All right. Daz, thanks for joining us. You're back next week.
Will do. Absolutely.
Yep. All right. We'll be back after this to wrap up. Welcome back to Hold All Tickets. We are just here to wrap up this weekend's episode because, well, there's been a lot on, but we'll bring back the top five next week, I believe.
Yeah, I've got a bit of material for a top five next week. Not necessarily racing related, but just something I need to get off my chest.
I like it. All right, thanks for joining us this week on Hold All Tickets. They're brought to you by Betfair. On your side this autumn racing season, check out Betfair today. Now head across to Punters to check out all the written previews that are done for this weekend, as well as all the social content going out regarding everything. We've got Rapid Race, we've got the Quokka, the Western Trilogy, all of it covered for your needs this weekend. We'll catch you next week. You're on Hold All Tickets.
What are you prepared to lose today? Set a deposit limit. For free and confidential support, call the number on the screen or visit the website.